Hi, everyone. My name's Alex. Welcome to this session. For everyone who's new to this, just want to let you know if you have any technical issues, just use the question box located in the navigation panel. You can also use that same box for any questions along the way. We'll try to answer that during the Q&A session. We're also recording today's session, and this is going to be emailed at the end, so look for that in your email inbox. And lastly, we do have everyone muted just to avoid background noise and distractions. So with that, let's get started. So I'm going to be talking to you today about why voice control is so hard. And for those who don't know, my name is Alex Capisalatro. I'm the CEO and co-founder of Josh.ai. This is me presenting at CEDIA, I think last year or maybe the year before. And I've spent an entire career really learning about cutting edge technology, how to implement it, how to use it. And with my company, Josh.ai, we do a lot with voice control, artificial intelligence, and really kind of pushing where things are going. And so along the way, we've learned a lot of reasons that voice control can be pretty difficult, and I've got some recommendations we're going to cover today. In terms of a quick outline, first, just a quick note that voice control is everywhere. It's a very fast-growing field, but it's still far from perfect. We're going to talk a little bit about microphones and the acoustics around how that has something to do with why it's sometimes difficult. We're going to dive into ASR, which is automatic speech recognition. That's converting your spoken word into text. And then NLP, which is natural language processing, and that's actually analyzing the text to figure out what the meaning is. We're going to talk a little bit about integrations and the network and how that contributes, and then where we're going from here, sort of a look into the future. So just to get started, I think it's really interesting here to note that in December of 2017, we already had about 67 million people in the United States using voice control. That was a huge number. It was up from almost zero just a few years earlier, but then it went up to 119 million a year later, and then 157 million the year after that. As you can see, this number is growing exponentially. And what this means is voice control is everywhere. Whether we want to use it or not, voice control is something our clients are going to be asking about. We're going to be seeing big tech companies pushing. And so I wanted to bring this talk topic up because I think it's really important to understand why voice control is hard and what we can do about it, especially as so many people are using voice control. One thing to note really quick, when you research and Google this stuff, you'll see that a lot of people are still complaining because voice control is far from perfect. This is an example of a Reddit thread from not too long ago where someone's asking, is Alexa getting worse? Basically, they're saying that it's understanding less, it's refusing to do certain things, it's randomly doing other things. And the reality is voice control is an evolving space. It's always changing. And I think it's worth noting that we're going to have to deal with this. And I think as integrators and custom installers, we as an industry need to understand how does it work? And therefore, how do we work with it? How do we make it something that we can really get our hands around and make it successful for our clients? So let's dive into why exactly is voice control so hard? So here's a quick drawing I put together. It's nothing fancy. But what we're looking at is the device in the middle, and the four black boxes represent microphones. In the middle is the DSP, which is the digital signal processor. And what's happening is these four microphones are essentially beamforming. They're listening to audio in all directions. And the DSP is running algorithms to try to figure out what is the actual user's voice command and what's background noise. So you see on the left that a voice command comes in, those audio signals need to be processed. But in the bottom right, we have background noise coming in. Maybe that's from the television or an HVAC that's running, or just people kind of playing and making noise. And so you have to basically increase the signal, reduce the noise, and then you have other factors to worry about. So in the top, I mentioned dust is an issue, vibration can be an issue, acoustic echo cancellation, which is when the device is actually speaking. It needs to ignore itself, but listen to the human, and essentially decipher out on the right that the user said, turn on the lights, for example. So there's a lot that needs to go in to make this right, and it's so easy to go wrong if the device is positioned improperly, if the microphones get dirty, if there's too much background noise or reverberation, all these things can cause a real negative impact. So with that, one of the things that people don't focus on enough, in my opinion, is microphone placement. It's very easy, as I mentioned, to have the microphone placed improperly. You'll notice behind me, for example, I've got a microphone that's on the wall. The fact that it's on the wall means it's got easy access to my voice command. It doesn't have anything obstructing it. It's at about 56 inches off the ground, which is kind of ideal for hearing human speech, and it ends up working well. But when you're dealing with your microphones, if you plug it into an outlet, if you have it on a tabletop, you want to be really mindful that if people start putting books in front of it, or if it's in a room that doesn't have the best acoustics, you're going to really impact and interfere with the ability for the microphone to work well. So just something that you want to think about is, where's the microphone placed? How are the acoustics in the room? And what can you do to try to make those variables a lot better to improve your performance? The next thing I want to cover is mishearings, and in particular, the section on ASR, or automatic speech recognition. And as I mentioned, ASR is taking the actual audio wave, so the sound that's being emitted from my mouth, and it's converting that into text. And it's doing so using a probabilistic method. And the method is flawed in many ways, but still pretty amazing. And so I want to show a couple examples of why it's difficult and sort of what we can do about it. So the first thing is, you need a ton of training data. For those who recognize this image, this is from a YouTube video where this kid is asking for a certain song. I don't remember what the song is, but he's a four-year-old, I think. And so his voice is very different than what a human adult voice would sound like. And the net result is, in this video, it mishears him as asking for porno and starts giving a porn response, which is terrible for a four-year-old. But the idea is that a voice of a child is different than the voice of a middle-aged man, different than a woman, different than someone who's a little bit older. And then you add in accents. In order to properly understand what's being said, you need to map the sound of a word to the actual word. And then you need to add these probabilistic models, like hidden Markov models, HMMs, in order to figure out what's the most likely word being said. So an example of this would be, if I said the word chow, and the model were an English model, maybe for someone in San Francisco in their 30s, it probably is C-H-O-W. Like, I want to order some food from Chow Now, that would probably get her to C-H-O-W. But if you were an Italian speaker, maybe even in Italy, and you said Chow as in hello or goodbye, the spelling in that case is C-I-A-O. And so the same sounding word needs to turn into different text. And that gets really tough if your models aren't fit to your user. And so one of the ways to think about this is, if your client happens to be someone who, again, has a thick accent, maybe they speak a different language, you want to really understand if models have been optimized for that person. Because today, we don't have models for every language and every accent. There's certain languages, certain accents, and certain demographics that are going to work better than others. The next thing is, even when you get those words being heard, they're going to be misheard quite often. So these are a couple examples that have come up in my experience. The first one is, if I say something like, would you turn on the lights? It might mishear that as would, W-O-O-D. That obviously would do the wrong thing if your engine didn't account for it. The second one is weekend. They sound very similar. You know, louder. I'm even getting these confused. This comes up all the time. For example, you walk in a room and you say, make the music louder. Well, your system might hear make the music louder. Certain voice assistants are going to be able to handle this and figure it out. But let's say you had a scene and your scene were tied to a control system specifically for make the music louder. Well, if you didn't account for this mishearing, when it hears L-A-D-D-E-R, it's going to end up doing the wrong thing. So something you want to be aware of. Sun and sun sound exactly the same. Or one of my favorites at the bottom, open the grape, as a mishearing for open the drape. So again, this is just part of why voice control is hard. In some cases, the voice assistants are solving this. In other cases, you might need to solve for this if you're making custom room names or device names or scenes. And so sort of along the same lines, you get different interpretations when you give a command. So in this case, you might hear make the lights red, or make the lights bread. Clearly the right one in this case would be make the lights RED, assuming it's a color-changing light. But it's a hard thing to disambiguate at times. And so that gets us into the next phase, which is, once you get the audio turned into text, you need to process that text. And so this is where the NLP, or the natural language processing, comes in. And one of the great famous examples in the research fields around NLP is this one: time flies like an arrow, fruit flies like a banana. Obviously, two different interpretations, but it shows the ambiguity. Just to make it more clear, in case it's I'm speaking a little bit too fast, So time flies like an arrow, suggesting the way that time flies is fast or swift, like an arrow. But fruit flies like banana is saying fruit flies as the noun. So what you see on the right is we actually have a named entity recognition engine and a lot of voice assistants that try to figure out what's the noun, what's the verb, what's the adjective. So here I just put in learn about voice control at CEDIA, and you'll see that learn is highlighted as the verb, the noun is voice control. And then the second one, it actually recognizes that CEDIA is an organization. And so this is part of how we get better. But if you're using a organization or a name that the system doesn't recognize, it might not understand that fruit flies is one word or one, you know, noun, as opposed to time flies being two separate words. And that ambiguity is part of why voice control is so hard. The other thing is there are so many different ways to ask for the same thing. This is asking for just a simple 6 a.m. alarm, but you could say, wake me up at 6 a.m., 6 a.m. set my alarm, I need to get up at 6 a.m., and on and on. And it turns out there are actually literally millions of ways to ask for a 6 a.m. alarm clock. You start adding the word please in the beginning or end, or may I, and it just becomes very complicated. And so there are times where certain ways to give a command will work, but other ways might not work just because there's so many ways to give a command. And again, voice assistants are largely handling this. This is something that, whether it's Google, Amazon, or Josh AI, they're all sort of working on making this better. But it's one of the reasons that this is a really hard technology to work on. And then the other thing is the ambiguity of what you're asking for can get very tough. So an example here is turn on X. If you're in a room and you say turn on the living room, maybe you mean turn on the lights, maybe you mean turn on the TV in that room, maybe the fan, maybe a bunch of that. But then if you get into turn on the Beatles, to us, that's obviously music. But if you said turn on the television, that's obviously a device type. Turn on Breaking Bad, the second case here, that would be a TV show on Netflix. And it just gets very complicated. And just to highlight this a little bit more, you have to essentially end up utilizing a knowledge graph that says, what is X? Is the Beatles a musician, an album, a TV show, a device, a room? And that gets very complicated depending on how the architecture of your voice assistant is built. Turn on the lights gets hard because it turns out there's a show on YouTube called The Lights. I think there's a show on Netflix called The Lights. Plenty of songs called The Lights. There's an artist called The Lights. But obviously if you're in a room giving a command, turn on the lights is most likely to mean the overhead lights above you. But it just goes to prove that voice control is a very tough problem and there are a lot of ambiguities. And so you want to be a little lenient at this point with, it's not always going to be perfect, but it is getting a lot better, a lot faster. Next thing is when you're dealing with scenes, scenes don't have any knowledge about what's going on. Think of a scene as hitting a black box button. You don't know what's going to happen. And so an example is if you have a scene called turn on the kitchen lights, but then the user were to say, turn on the lights in the kitchen, a natural language command would have gotten that, but a scene would not because a scene needs to directly say what it's going to do. It's not flexible. And so we always recommend don't use scenes unless absolutely necessary. The best scenes would be something like good morning, good night, maybe dinner time. But beyond that, you don't want to have a scene for turn on the kitchen lights because as we mentioned, there are millions of ways to say turn on the kitchen lights and you're never going to capture them all just using scene aliases. And then the last thing is one of the reasons voice control is hard, especially in the home, you're naming rooms, you're naming devices, you're naming scenes. And sometimes what you name them in the programming doesn't match what the user says. So an example of this would be at the bottom, turn off living room under cabinet lights. Well, if that's not what you called the device, the system's not gonna know what you're talking about. So you wanna be really careful to understand what are all the ways the end user might refer to this room, refer to this device, or refer to the scene. And there are ways that the systems are getting better. For example, in Josh AI, the system that I work on, if you have a room called the gym and you said, turn on the lights in the fitness room, our system automatically understands that those things are common synonyms and it'll just work. But depending on your system, that's not always gonna happen. So you wanna be really mindful of this. The next thing is a common phrase that those of us in the industry often talk about internally, which is this: the idea that you want the system to do what I want, not what I say. And the idea of this is that when we say literally what we want, it's not always what we actually want. So an example of this would be if I walk in a room and say, turn it up, Well, am I asking to turn up the light brightness, turn up the music volume, turn up the TV volume, turn up the thermostat? It's very ambiguous. And if the system simply does what I'm saying, turn it up, it might either do the wrong thing or it might do nothing at all. And that's not what the user wants. The next one is if you walk in and say, I'm freezing. Well, that's not a command that you're directly asking for something. But we understand that that means that the user's cold. Is there a way to make the room warmer? Is there a thermostat adjustment? Maybe you've got, you know, something else that's causing the room to be cold, the fans on, for example. And so this is where the AI needs to figure out what to do. And the third example, similar, you walk in a room and say, turn on the music. It needs to figure out, well, what music should I turn on? If nothing's queued up, what should I load into the player? And this is ambiguous because the direct definition of turn on the music might mean power up the amps, but you don't care that it's turned on. You care that music is playing. And so again, we just want to think about, it's not what the user is saying that we should do, it's what's their intent. What is it that they're actually trying to accomplish? The next reason that voice control is hard is that it relies on integrations in the home. You might be hooking into a lighting system, a music system, an HVAC system, an AV system, and all of these different systems have different capabilities. Unfortunately, not every API is created equally. And so you want to really think ahead of time about, am I creating a system that's going to play well together? Do I understand the sandbox? Do I understand what's going to work? Because the most frustrating thing is when a client thinks they're going to be able to walk into a room and say, watch channel 7, but the reality is the AV equipment they have isn't consistent and capable of doing that with the voice assistant that they've got. So integrations are one of the main reasons that we see people struggle. And it's one of the reasons that voice control is hard. There's so many possible devices to integrate with, but the more that you can stick to a sandbox, the better you can control this. And lastly, one of the ones we want to bring up is, unfortunately, your voice assistants do require a good network right now. I say unfortunately because you don't always have this capability. Maybe you're in the mountains, maybe you're putting your system onto a yacht. And if you don't have a good network, you're not going to be able to deliver a good voice assistant because the models are so heavy right now, they do involve going out to the cloud. And this is true for Amazon, Google, Apple, Josh AI, they all currently require the network. And so voice control is going to struggle if you don't have a good network. And it's one of those core components that you want to think about. So with that, I want to think a little bit about, where do we go from here? What's the next frontier? And the reality is this stuff is moving fast. The companies like us and Google and Amazon and others that make voice assistants, we have teams that are constantly working on making this better. But we want you and we want your clients to understand that while it's getting better, it still has a lot of room to go. And the more that you understand why it might fail, the more tolerance and understanding you have when something goes wrong. The other thing about where we go from here, I encourage you to really understand, what are the different assistants? What are the different capabilities? What is able to sort of solve the problem that your client's looking for? Because the more that you're able to answer their questions and deliver an experience that works for them, the happier they'll become. And for example, in my home, I'm very used to using voice for lights, for shades, for music, for HVAC, for certain things. And as a result, I have a great experience, but I know how the stuff works. And therefore I know that I position my microphones in the right place. I speak to it clearly. I'm tolerant if there's background noise that it might not succeed in that moment. And all of these things are just truths of how voice control works today that I recommend you understand, and you educate your clients that they understand how to get the best out of their voice assistants and their voice platforms. So with that, happy to take any questions you might have. Feel free to put them right in the chat box. For more information, in case we don't get to it today, feel free to email member@cedia.org or visit cedia.net/join. Then also want to thank everyone for attending. So again, feel free to shoot over an email. You can also reach out to me directly at alex@josh.ai. And just want to encourage you to look into all the CEDIA resources, read the CEDIA blog, make sure you have access to the CEDIA Academy. There's so much great content out there. And thank you so much for spending the time. Thanks, guys.